I would like to introduce you to Peter Hallward, who is a professor at Kingston University, philosopher, who has worked a lot on modern continental philosophy. He's wrote books on Alain Badiou and Gilles Deleuze, and also on Haitian politics. And with him, we have Panagiotis Sotiris, who now works as a journalist and editor, and who has written a lot on Gramsci, popular sovereignty, Pulanza's also political theory in general, and he's also a philosopher. And they're here today to discuss issues regarding the will of the people, popular sovereignty, especially seen in the light of what happened with Brexit, and maybe also the Ochi vote. And so what is the status today of the will of the people? So I will give the word to Peter Hallward. Let me just say practical stuff. They will speak for about 20-25 minutes each, and after that we'll open the floor for questions and some collective discussion, debate, dialogue, whatever.
Still something could be, that it would be easier or less difficult to imagine a revolution at the European scale than on the British or even English scale. But I don't mean to rehearse all of that, it's more the form of the argument that interests me. And there are four reasons why I think that the Brexit vote was not a good example of a will of the people. And I'm going to go through these and at the same time build up a picture of what I think of the will of the people might mean in a progressive, philosophically consequential way. In other words, a term that I think can be salvaged, should be salvaged, that is fundamental to an understanding of democracy, meaning broadly popular empowerment, popular sovereignty, that kind of thing. And that in fact this term, and perhaps especially in English, this term, the will of the people, although it's an almost hopeless cliché, is actually a very useful term. Because of the slightly slippery notion of these two terms, will and people, and I'll go through this. So, the first reason why I think the Brexit vote was not a good example for an expression of the will of the people was the insistence on its unique, irrevocable, a definitive, irreversible quality, which you have in all the quotes I just gave. What's done is done, the British people have spoken, let's move on. And almost everybody insists on this, including, for example, last week, Yanis Varoufakis, who I imagine is a controversial figure on the left in Greece, but who spoke last week to the English journal The New Statesman. And he said, and as you know, Varoufakis campaigned against Brexit, was quite an influential figure, in fact, in Britain during those debates. And precisely because of his experience in Greece, could come and say, listen, I'm no friend of the European Union, but nevertheless, you should stay in a reformed EU. Even Varoufakis says, quote, as Democrats, we must accept the result of the referendum. To seek to overturn it through a second vote would be to do to the British people what the European Union did to the Irish over the Lisbon Treaty, you know, to keep posing referenda until eventually you get the answer that you want. So in a sense, Varoufakis also is saying, well, what's done is done. And the assumption is always that there was a referendum, one referendum, it happened, the result is in, now we move on. And it's precisely this that I don't agree with, in principle, the idea that there can be one irreversible vote which then decides a political project for this foreseeable future. The problem with this referendum, in fact, was not that there was one referendum, but that there was only and that only one referendum was used by many different people for many different reasons to answer many different questions. So precisely because there had been nothing like a referendum on austerity, on neoliberal labor laws, on integration with the European Union, on migration, on education, on tuition fees, on the privatization of virtually every aspect of public life, dot, 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 many things you could have a referendum on. But there never was, and there was never anything like a referendum. There was never anything like an election, for example, that offered a real alternative choice. Britain, like many other parts of Europe, has been an effectively single-party state for the last 30 years, really ever since Thatcher. Blair is a repackaged version of Thatcher with some tweaks, and Cameron is a repackaged version of Blair. So there was no opportunity for public decision-making, public choice, until the referendum came along. And the referendum offered a genuine choice, a very crude and simplistic choice in a way, and people used it to express all kinds of different opinions. And this is clear, it's clear at the time, but it's particularly clear afterwards, that the analyses of voting preferences and so on show that it combined good old-fashioned English xenophobia and racism, anti-immigrant feeling, all kinds of things like that, as well as a lot of perfectly genuine and perfectly reasonable anxiety about precarious work, about the future, about unemployment, particularly about things like outsourcing, the loss of jobs, and so on. And this single referendum then confused and conflated all these different questions, which meant that the answer was at the very best obscure. The reference is always then, if we were to have another referendum, it's decried in exactly the way that Varoufakis just does in that quote, a second vote, or another referendum would be treated as an overturning of the first one. Whereas what's actually been offered by the parties who do support another vote. The Green Party, on the sort of left of the spectrum, some of the people around Corbyn in, on the Labour Party, as well as more mainstream politicians like the Blairites, a lot of them, and some of the Lib Dems as well. It's not a second referendum, but another referendum, a follow-up referendum, which would effectively be the first referendum on the actual terms of departure. So this is, I think, perfectly reasonable, almost should be uncontroversial argument that if you respect the will of the people and took them seriously on the vote to leave, then you could also give them the respect of having an opinion about the terms for the departure. And it's hard to understand, in principle, why you would support one and not the other. And if you refer back to what I think of as the grounding philosophical framework for talking about the will of the people, so for me that is Rousseau and some of the contemporaries like Mably and then some of the French revolutionaries inspired by Rousseau, one of the things that they hold in common is, yes, you take the will of the people seriously. The will of the people is indeed the expression of sovereign power. But by definition, a sovereign cannot bind itself by its own decrees. So a sovereign contradicts the very idea of sovereign lawmaking power, that a vote it might give on an issue one day would be binding for the future. He says, Rousseau puts this clearly, he says, it's contrary to the nature of the body politic, meaning sovereign, for the sovereign to impose on itself a law which it cannot break. Of course the sovereign can break its own laws. The sovereign makes the laws, it can remake them, it can change them, and the whole work of politics is understanding that these things are dynamic processes that are constantly open to rediscussion, renegotiation, rethinking, where it's the prevailing view that has to win the argument, and it has to constantly win the argument. The argument is never just won and resolved, and then we all go to sleep. The argument is constantly debated and discussed and argued. What is not up for discussion is the sovereignty of the people themselves. And what Rousseau would find very ironic about this whole situation is that the actual situation we have in Britain is one in which the sovereignty of the people is not, in fact, acknowledged. I mean, we can perhaps come back to that. So that's the first reason, is that I don't think we should characterize, in principle, Brexit as an example of the will of the people, because the nature of the will of the people is that it can change and that it's an ongoing process. That it's in fact a perfectly ordinary process. It doesn't have once in a lifetime, decrees. It's the ongoing process of working out what is in the common interest or what it is that the people want. Part of the reason, by the way, just parenthetically, why I think this confusion happened is that a distinction that was very clear in ancient Greek democratic theory was conflated in modern Britain, which is the difference between an election and a vote, or a majority vote. So an election, as I'm sure all of you know, was always condemned by Greek democrats as oligarchic or aristocratic by definition, because of course you can buy an election, because elections favor those who are already prominent and privileged and connected and so on. So electoral politics have always been treated with a certain suspicion. You can be preferred to voting by lot or some other forms of choosing representatives or political leaders who are not based on elections. There's a big difference then between an election and a majority vote, which is a revolutionary innovation of Greek democracy. So Sainte-Croix, the historian of ancient Greek democracy, says that was the revolutionary breakthrough. The idea that a decision could be taken by a mass of people, where each head or each person, each citizen, counts equally with others, and you simply calculate the majority vote as a numerical fact. And what happened with Brexit, I think, is that that majority vote was conflated with something like an election, a one-off definitive vote that would set a kind of future. Same thing when Brexit is treated as similar to Trump's election, whereas in fact, of course, they're totally different types of things. Trump's election is unequivocally an election, whatever you think about the result. That's the first reason. Second reason why I don't think Brexit is a good example of the will of the people is that it forgets a very important distinction that's basic to modern understandings of sovereignty, which is the difference between government and sovereign. So It's arguable that this difference does not apply so clearly in antiquity, but it's important for the modern thinkers of sovereignty, Rousseau, of course, but his following Baudin and Hobbes, particularly Baudin, I think, who distinguish between a sovereign power, the power to command, the ultimate source of authority, and then the execution of those commands by the government, or by the agents, the executives, who are nominated to carry out the command. And the relation is very clear, as you can see. The commander commands an obedient servant, the government. And the system is working well, Rousseau emphasizes this in particular, when the government is as pliable as possible to the commands of the sovereign. So the best situation is one where you have a popular sovereign, organized, you know, in his terms, virtuous, clear, decisive, etc., with a pliable government that has only the power it needs to carry out the commands. Now that is a certain amount of power, it has to be effective enough at doing what it's told. But the big, many problems start for Rousseau when the government usurps the sovereign power and starts in fact commanding the people, which Rousseau says, by the way, is always going to happen. It will always tend to happen, at least. And you have to go to great lengths to try to avoid it. So you can ask yourself in a question like Brexit, so was this an example of a sovereign popular power? Was it a grassroots mobilization that represented an opportunity for popular empowerment? Was it driven, you know, by mass organization from below? Or was it a government-led, top-down, rather tawdry parliamentary maneuver to basically try to sort out some problems for the ruling party in parliament? And in my opinion, it's very clearly the latter. Cameron only instituted, you know, he set the whole thing up because it would allow him to see off a threat to his right flank in some marginal seats. In Britain, see off the UKIP party, if you're familiar with the machinations of it. But although there was a lot of popular discontent with neoliberal austerity, with a lot of the things associated with the European Union, there was no mass movement for something like a Brexit vote. I think really on the contrary. First of all, it was a top-down government-led maneuver, not a sovereign popular maneuver from below. Second, the promise that was given that it would restore sovereignty, restore popular sovereignty, the slogan that you see everywhere in populist circles, right-wing primarily, to take back control, which was very prominent in the British debate as well, is itself, I think, a clear deception, because it's right to associate sovereignty with control and command. That's what sovereign power is, the power to command. The question is, what is it that the British people can command? What is it the British people can control? And they can control a certain number of important things. There is, I think, still a meaningful level of popular, or at least national, self-determination around issues like health and education and the distribution of public services, a certain amount of redistribution. These are not trivial things, they're very important, I think. But a lot of the issues that were debated in Britain were not to do with that primarily. And in fact, on those questions, I think popular opinion remains very strongly left of the political mainstream. The people fighting for Brexit are in fact the people who want to privatize the state. I mean the dominant people fighting for Brexit, the people who really led the Brexit campaign, are the most radical neoliberals, the people who want to go further with neoliberal privatization and so on. So you have that paradox. But in particular, the control that people want back, particularly control over things like neoliberal financialization or outsourcing or precarity or these kinds of fundamental economic questions, is not a control that even a left-wing British parliament can execute or exercise without something like a revolutionary change in the balance of power. The only way you would get control over things like that is if you had a popular force that was able and willing to nationalize a great deal of the economy, to undertake radical changes in the organization of labor, to change, you know, a great many things, and there is no such organization, there is no such movement. There are some people who would like it, and there are some people even around on the left edge of the Corbyn movement, of momentum, and so on, who would like to press for this. But at the time of Brexit, at least, this was at the level of political wish, not the level of political will. So it was a kind of mirage, same kind of mirage you see being manipulated by the Front National in France and many other places. Take back control, but without an account or an actor or a process for actually doing that. So it's a promise. And people like control, yes, self-control is good, control over one's destiny is an important thing. And I would love, politically I think it's something indeed to aspire to, but you have to be clear about how to get there, how to do it. And the Brexit vote, I think, had very little to do with that. Third reason, then, so first of all, I'm saying that it wasn't a good example of popular sovereignty or political will of the people, because it was presented as irreversible and unique, a one-off vote, as opposed to an ongoing process. Second, that it was a mirage of sovereign power, it didn't have the power actually to command. And the third reason has to do with the understanding of the people in question. And this is a notoriously loose and problematic term, and there are people in this room who have spent a lot of time thinking about this. And we do need to pause here and ask, so well, what do we mean by this term, the people? And I have a very simplistic, reductive answer to this. But which I'll come to in a second. On balance, I think the discussion tends to veer between two extreme positions, poles. One is that you equate people with the conservative, sometimes even fascistic, understanding of the nation. You know, ethnically homogeneous or relatively so, more or less historically homogeneous as well, an exclusive community held together, you know, by its dominant forces, its ruling class, its traditions, perhaps its language, and so on. The term that I like for this is not nation, which I think is actually quite an equivocal term, perhaps unusable now, but has a history that is worth trying to remember, the history of national liberation movements in particular. It has connotations that I think are not unsalvageable, despite the use of the term now. The term that I like is a little older, and it's an anachronistic English term of the realm, meaning the kingdom, perhaps, or the royaume, the idea of a space structured by its forms of rule and domination, and its geography and its history. So the combination of forms of rule, geographic space and variety of geographic space, historical continuity of some sort, make up a kind of the lineage, if you like, the spread, the space of a realm. And it's this idea then of something that's relatively stable. If you know the English tradition, it would be associated with someone like Burke, radical critic of the French Revolution. Something that's grounded in tradition, even in his case, in kind of bigoted prejudice. He's quite happy, pretty much, to use the term prejudice. Conservative, established traditions. So that's one understanding of the people. The people would be the body of the nation in this sense. The other, homogeneous, concentrated in on itself. The other extreme is the opposite to that, which would be the dispersal of anything that would unite or organize a people in a kind of sort of quasi-anarchistic suspension of all criteria, such that dispersal itself is left as the dominant criterion. And here, I'll just mention briefly a couple of figures who I think could be read along these lines. I'm going to just give some names, but Deleuze would be one, Agamben and his emphasis on constituent power would be another. But the most interesting, the most sympathetic for me would be Rancière, Jacques Rancière, who I think has done the most in contemporary French circles to revive the question of democracy, pose questions about the people and what the people is, broadly in sympathetic terms, so defending concepts of the people, mainly from the 19th century, but using it as a lever to get at a whole range of quite interesting and important philosophical distinctions and differences, often with reference to antiquity. But what he emphasizes in his defense of the people is its capacity to undo all forms of classification, or all forms of differentiation, or all forms in particular of a hierarchy, a lot of which is, I think, very important and sympathetic. But he stresses, quote, then, the power to undo all gatherings, partnerships, coordinations. He says the power of demos, the power of equality and so on, is, quote, the power of inconsistent, disintegrative, and ever-replayed division, which tears politics away from the various figures of unity, homogeneity, you know, realm-like unity that I was talking about a second ago. So what you find, I think, emphasized in Rancière, perhaps because he's reacting against these more homogeneous figures, is dispersal itself. And he's always very worried about anything that might lend a kind of coherence or stability or unity or organized shape to a mass movement or a popular movement. And for him, that starts to look immediately like a form of oppression. And for me this is a problem, because you cannot organize popular power unless you have forms of organization, by definition, that lend it some force and shape and momentum. And we need to be able to reinvent those, or redevelop those, reassert those. And that, I think, is not Rancière's strength. In between those two poles, well, there's lots of different positions, I think, and perhaps we can come back to them. I want to make basically two quick points about the people. I think that to treat it as a sociological entity, so the people as a kind of empirical object, a population, the only thing that can be said of the people, the only defensible thing, is simply that it is a massing together of people, a grouping as such, with no other criterion. So no historical criterion, no geographic criterion, no linguistic criterion, no other criteria, in fact, apart from the fact that, for whatever reason, at a certain point, the people in question can come together in some way that is clear for themselves. So they can mass together. And that happened, let's say, during the French Revolution, happens again in different ways in the Russian Revolution. But an example that interests me quite a bit is the Haitian Revolution, less familiar to the into mainstream historiography, but a process that overlaps to some extent with the French Revolution, where a group of people from very different parts of Africa, and some others as well, come together and find a way to join their forces in order to pursue their own emancipation. And in doing so, in all these different ways, they form themselves into something like what they call a peuple, or a people, with a common, some kind of common purpose. So empirically, or as an object, I would say a people is simply that, a massing together. And there's no criteria there in principle for how big that mass could be. It might, you know, for Rousseau, the mass that he tends to imagine are fairly small and homogeneous, but that doesn't follow from his definition of a people as a generalizing of a purpose. That it can be as big as the mass itself, as its capacity, basically, to grow. It has only one operative distinction, which is the mass itself, the massing together of people as such, and then those who might want to separate themselves from that mass, to insist then on some kind of difference or privilege or power that the rest of the people do not have. So this is the kind of crude us or them distinction, which I think is basic to a notion of the people, that the people distinguishes itself from those they perceive as their enemies, their adversaries, people who want to reassert some kind of difference that would divide the mass, reassert the logic, if you like, of the realm. But that's the only operative distinction. One of the reasons why Brexit then is a problem is that the distinctions that separated people in the Brexit vote did not fall down this simple, rather simplistic division, but in fact split opinion in all kinds of complicated ways. That's itself, I think, a symptom of the way that Brexit was problematic. So that's the, I wanted to emphasize then, first, the lack of any further specification. The people in this very vacuous, almost, you know, sociologically empty sense, which is captured well by the English term, better than the French term, peuple. You can't go from a peuple to just people in general. You have to change words and talk about les gens. Maybe in archaic usage, les hommes, les êtres humains, something like that. But in English, you can go from our people, the people, this people, to just people. And that, I think, is a virtue of the English usage. It is that generic quality of people, just people. People with no other criteria or distinction. That's, by the way, what you get in Rousseau, who, when he talks about what is a people, you know, what makes a people, he says virtually nothing about it, actually. He just says, I'll assume les hommes, so people, have reached a point where they need to combine their forces. They need, in other words, to form a mass. This is, if you're curious, it's the Social Contract, Book 1, Chapter 6. And in three paragraphs, with no detail at all, really, with no specification, with no discussion of language or geography or history, he just says, people come together and they form a mass by aggregation and cooperation. And that, I think, then, is the fundamental thing about what a people is sociologically, and that will take me then to my last point, and I'm sorry I'm running over a little bit, which is that as an actor, as something that has an active capacity, all that a people has, I think, put this in slightly hyperbolic terms, is its capacity to share a will, to participate in a common will. So this is Rousseau's understanding, essentially, of a general will. And that, that criterion of there is a people, politically, when there is a capacity to share a common will, at whatever scale, whether that's very small or very big, whether it's a patriotic internationalist project or at the scale of a global political movement like the communist movement was once, or something very small in a local neighborhood, that is the fundamental operator, the capacity to share in a common purpose that is a purpose, that has the connotations that, again, the English term will usefully brings with it. It's willed, it's voluntary, it's conscious, it's purposeful. It is aware of itself, it's clear, it's lucid, it's educated, it knows what it's doing. These are the criteria for things that are voluntary as opposed to involuntary. And it's, that is the critical operator then. People is simply a mass of individuals who, for whatever reason and by whatever means, acquire a capacity to formulate a common will and then to exercise it. And I'll just end on, just remember three other really basic things about what a will is, again in the English usage. A will is different from just a wish or a want. And in French, again, there's an equivocation there because volonté, vouloir, these verbs you can translate as wanting or willing. And in English, the difference is clear enough. You only will something, you want it, yes, the wanting is the beginning, but to will it, you have to be able to do it. You have to be able, at least in principle, you might not succeed, but to actually do it. So to turn a wish into a will is to turn it into an actual project, a concrete project with an end, which means then that an end that requires certain means to exercise it. So to will the end, as the cliche goes, is to will the means. That's an important dimension. It's not just a wish. Second, that it connotes then as voluntary this informed, aware, conscious, purposive dimension. And it's very striking, I think, that the emphasis on sovereignty and its link to capacity, deliberation, consciousness, purpose, and so on, is precisely the target for a lot of contemporary work in philosophy. It's perceived as a problem. So Agamben is a really interesting case, but Derrida as well, Deleuze too. Many of the contemporary philosophers who are most influential target precisely this, because of its fascistic connotations in part, but in principle they target this, and in doing so make the whole concept of popular sovereignty a more or less unthinkable aporia. And finally, there's a difference between the will of the people and a simple popular preference or popular opinion or aggregate of preferences, what Rousseau called a will of all, la volonté de tous, and a general will. The general will of volonté générale, or a popular will, is one that proceeds through collective action, through deliberation, through discussion, through deliberation, and so on, that consolidates it as, again, as an ongoing project. And it's that makes it a will and not just an opinion or a preference. So if it's a will, if it emerges collectively, if it's purposeful and conscious and clear about itself, and if finally it has the capacity to impose itself, capacity then to overcome the resistance of that which might stand in its way. And on those criteria, I don't think that Brexit is a very good example of a political will in that sense.
Without statement criteria or a common guideline. This is not some leftist or radical activist speaking. This is the European Commissioner for Economic and Financial Affairs, Taxation and Customs, Pierre Moscovici, in a rare moment of sincerity regarding the workings of the very institution he forms part of. A couple of years earlier, it was the President of the European Commission, Jean-Claude Juncker, who said that there is no choice against the European treaties. I think that his statements encapsulate the problems that we're discussing today. And the entire trajectory of the Greek crisis, apart from everything else, has been an exercise in what a condition of reduced sovereignty means. Now, this is something, of course, that has been repeated in many instances in the past years, and perhaps by itself it doesn't mean much. But it has been suggested one way or the other that in an era of globalization and greater interdependence between different countries and with increased power of global capital and global money flows, no country is fully sovereign in the sense that it used to be. Others would point to the fact that reduced sovereignty, ceding some aspects of sovereignty in order to achieve cooperation and even integration, has been a crucial aspect of the European project from the beginning of the 1950s, a way to curb excess nationalism, and it had been from the beginning accepted by everyone participating in it. However, I think there is something more. In the case of the European integration process, reduced sovereignty has been not just an objective result of the particular European form of globalization, it has also been a class strategy. The European Union is not a federal state. It's not even, in analytical terms, a supranational state form. It remains a multi-level and necessarily contradictory and hierarchical form of coordination between different social capitals and the forms of political representation. This is accomplished by the means of creation of numerous mutually penetrating networks of social, economic, political, ideological interconnections, which include a different levels of state, updated supranational mechanisms, nation states, regional administrations, multinational groups of companies, interest groups, whose reach is international. So this is the institutional framework of the European Union. But indeed, it is an aspect of it, this without precedent ceding of crucial aspects of sovereignty in favor of the institutions of the European Union. This is the paradox, indeed, of something that is not a supranational form, yet there is too much sovereignty ceded. Member states, especially of the Eurozone, have no control over monetary policy, have to coordinate their state borrowing practices, have to accept rigorous budgetary norms or face automatic penal mechanisms from the part of the supervising European institutions, have to accept fully opening their internal markets, including state procurements, have to comply with European regulations regarding the free movement of European citizens, including accepting rules regarding equivalences of degrees and qualifications. And moreover, they have to accept the forced privatization of the greatest part of their infrastructure, a process which has not already been underway. Now, so in this sense, we also have a particular form of European governance, it is a supranational form of neoliberal governance, which also is based upon this transfer of decision processes regarding especially regulatory functions. And of course, above all, we have a single currency, the euro, which in a certain way is the most important aspect of this mechanism of reduced sovereignty. Initially designed as a mechanism which would enhance the common market and create a unified economic space, and would enable the free flow of commodities and capitals and thus counter regional imbalances, it had, from the beginning, faced the problem of large divergences regarding competitiveness and productivity. Moreover, it was endowed from the beginning with an insistence on monetary discipline. Now, the non-federal character of the European Union meant that the only option to counter the divergences of productivity and competitiveness, which was, of course, strong regional redistribution, was excluded from the beginning. The idea was that member states, including those of the periphery, would cede sovereignty, refuse the protective mechanisms that were accustomed to, in order to take advantage from the competitive pressure induced by the exposure to foreign competition without protection mechanisms in order to promote capitalist restructuring and labor cost reduction, thus leading gradually to a more balanced monetary area, helped in this process by access to cheaper credit. So, of course, this is something evident even in the dates before the economic crisis of 2007 and 8. This constant exposure to international competition can continue to exist only through the continual adjustment of labor. Now, I think that if we see this mechanism, or especially the mechanism of the Eurozone, this can account for a paradox in this process. That is, the adherence of peripheral countries with serious productivity and competitiveness gaps with the core European countries to this aggressive regime of accumulation, this exposure to huge and pervasive competitive pressures. And I think this was exactly a strange kind of class compromise between the bourgeoisies or the dominant forces in the core countries and those in the peripheries. For the core countries, of course, a unified market with a single currency meant increased competitive advantages in the unified market. For the peripheral countries and the peripheral forces of capital, it meant that by means of exposure to stronger competition, this would create a very strong pressure towards labor. And this was basically the, let's say, the Davis kind of pact inside the European Union, which can account for this paradox, the fact that countries, and including social capitalists, see aspects of protection mechanisms and so on. And I think that this can account, if we see the European process not as an objective process, but as part of a class strategy, with a certain convergence between peripheral and core countries regarding the dominant social forces, this can explain, in my opinion, the reason why one should think in terms of a rupture, in terms of a potential Brexit. Of course, if we go, leave this level of abstraction and go towards the reality of Greek society, especially what it has been through since 2010, including what happened after 2015, we can see that the cost, the social cost that has been paid by Greek society in the name of this staying within the Eurozone has been 2 months greater. And it's very interesting that, as it has repeatedly said, all the dangers and all the damages that were supposed to be inflicted upon Greek society in case of a Brexit were inflicted upon it in the name of staying within the Eurozone. Now, moreover, it's interesting, and this is also an expression of that, I think that whatever has happened in Greece is not just a state of exception. It's not just a set of exceptionary measures used to correct a deviant country or a deviant society. I think it's in a certain way part of the new normal in Europe, and it's exactly the full expression of a mechanism of reduced sovereignty, a very particular form of disciplinary, non-federal kind of reduced sovereignty that has been imposed. And I think that what has been, in a certain way, let's say, design or a vision for after the end of the bailout programs in Greece attests to this. If you think that the supervisory mechanism is going to remain here even after the end of the bailout program, which is supposed to take place next year, if you take into consideration things like already voting future measures or accepting being committed to politics of austerity for decades, the current bailout, as part of the entry from the bailout program, the Greek government has accepted austerity until 2016. This for the entire period that the Greek debt is going to be repaired. I think you get a feeling of this, and this is, and if you look at the institutional framework, the current institutional framework, the Eurozone with the Stability Pact, and even if you see the current discussions at the European level regarding European economic governance, you get this is here something to stay. Even if there are symbolic moves like the so-called finance minister of the Eurozone, which supposedly or the functioning of the European Stability Mechanism as a version of the international, a European version of the International Monetary Fund, you're still going to get the same very strict mechanism with automatic breaks expenses, with penal mechanisms, and always the possibility of bailout programs. So I think if you take into consideration this, yes, you must try to think that there is no alternative to European rupture. Now, of course, and the Greek society was very close to that moment, and I think it's interesting to go back to the empty vote. In a sense, both of this expression of defiance against all these ideological currents of that period regarding the potential rupture. And we have to be honest, even though I'm not saying that the majority of Greek society, the majority of Greek voters would have voted for an exit from the Eurozone or the European Union, they accepted it as a potential outcome of their voting against the austerity measures at that particular moment, and this took form in an election, which I would call it as an expression of the will of the people, in the sense that it was not just a momentary expression, it sort of was the condensation of an entire social and political process. It had been debated, it had been deliberated, and the polarization of the vote, the referendum in Greece was perhaps the most polarized electoral process along class lines in recent Greek history. It doesn't coincide with the social aspects of the other elections. It was very specific. You could see it in terms of class position, you could see it in terms of the distribution of votes in different neighborhoods. It has been studied, it has been analyzed. So you had such an expression of always a subaltern vote, which was the culmination of an entire process, which in a very condensed, but yet with a certain duration kind of manner, expressed that Greek society was ready, not losing prepared, just ready, for a different course of action, provided of course that there have been other conditions. So I think this is something to take into consideration. Now, of course, people might say, and I understand this is part of this debate, why think about rupture when there is always the possibility of another Europe? Now, I think that in terms of this discussion of another Europe, it's like the old existential arguments regarding the existence of God and one of its refutations. The fact that you can think of something else does not equal that it can be accomplished. And because, yes, different, Europe could be different. There's no rational way to refute the fact that you have the European Central Bank would have dealt with the debt crisis much earlier and without social costs. There is possibility of redistributing a kind of redistribution interregional that would really create conditions for real convergence instead of nominal convergence, which was the Maastricht approach. And of course, we could also think of the European Union using its supranational kind of regulatory approach in order to enforce social rights rather than undermine them. Why did it happen? Why it has not happened for the past 30 years? It's because exactly the European construction was a convergence of class strategies. I mean, and I think if I say there is a moment of the final loss of innocence for the European Union, this is 1986, and the Single European Act. I mean, it's one thing to discuss in the 1970s a rather loose kind of common market with some coordination, progressive governments, things like that. But after 1986, after the beginning of the Maastricht Treaty process, formation of the European Union, all the varieties of European constitution, which care of function, I think this has been a non-reversible process. It's a process which cannot be reversed in its own terms. It can only be opposed to, and the way to oppose it, in my opinion, is a strategy of rupture. Of course, one might say, why not coordinate movements? Yes, this, first of all, because the institutional framework of the European Union is designed exactly in the aim of not enabling such a thing. There's no, in fact, European policy, a policy at the European level, which would enable perhaps the potential formation of a post-national European demos and a European patronism, as Hallward suggested, a European constitutional kind of patriotism. decision. This is the first impact at the European level. And of course, the main decision processes are still, to one way or the other, insulated against social movements. And apart from that, is the idea that is it possible to coordinate social movements along 27 countries with their different histories, temporalities, conditions, traditions, etc., etc. So, in contrast, I would say that a process of ruptures would create that kind of, let's say, violence, change in the balance of force, this kind of shock, political shock, that could indeed induce changes also at the European level. Now, there is the, and of course there is the question, which also came back up in the Brexit discussion, does the European Union guarantee social rights? Well, I think it's negative. I can understand that there is a small difference between the two sides of the British Channel, namely that this side of the British Channel, European regulation has been a mechanism to undermine social rights. That side of the British Channel, because of the extreme damage that the Thatcherism, in certain cases, some social rights were guaranteed by means of European legislation, but in most part, this doesn't. And the same, I think, goes for the rights of migrants and refugees. Yes, it is true that the European Union includes, as part of its founding principles, the free movement of European citizens, although not always with the same rights all everywhere. It's a sinister aspect, and sometimes we tend to forget that, for many instances, the idea of double standards has been part of the European institutional. And of course, Fortress Europe is closed against migrants and refugees from other countries, and there are too many, tragically many, dead people in the Mediterranean to say that the European Union is someone offers a guarantee of rights for migrants. Now, the question, and of course, just a small point. More general, I also think, but this could be another discussion, it's one thing to, it's always a problem to equalize the internationalization of capital with internationalism. This has been a very, very old tradition in ideological strategy in certain segments of the labor movement internationally for many, perhaps more than a century, that is, that if capital breaks down national barriers, it also brings forward the internationalism of the internationalism of the people. But I think that this doesn't hold much. I think that the internationalization of capital is the nationalism of capital, in fact. It's not our thing. Now, I think this is, if we take all this into consideration, I think this is why the question of rupture and Brexit comes forward. Does this mean a fallback internationalism? How are we going to deal with the fact that there are right-wing racist xenophobic forces that have also supported the various spaces of Europe this approach? Yes, this is a problem, but I think exactly that what I'm trying to say is that a strategy of rupture, a strategy of exit, is not just a question of what to do with a country. It's what to do with specific social forces. It has to do with subaltern classes. It is a class strategy in its own. And it's not, I would say that this holds both in terms of policies, specific policies. For example, I don't believe, although it has been suggested, and from people whose opinions I respect, that there's something irrational in the Eurozone, so exiting, reclaiming monetary sovereignty, for example, is an act of economic rationalism, which would enable increased social spending, etc., etc. I don't think that a potential exit in these terms would be only about growth or a better economy. It would be a change in the balance of forces, also the economy, and a different social and economic paradigm. And to give an example, especially European immigration, this is something that Britain does not have, but in countries from the European periphery, this is much more evident. The experience of immigration in the entire trajectory from and everything is working. It won't happen. It won't happen. It will happen for a very short time frame, some kind of growth there, but very short. You need to actually rebuild the productive capacity of the country. And in this strange sense, things like nationalizations, self-management, workers' control, things that come from a very radical tradition would also be from day one the necessary immediate measures in order to try and rebuild a country. So it's not just about that. So if in this sense, Brexit is not, or a potential Brexit, is not just about the relationship with the European Union. And if we treat it in such terms, then we fall back into the debate as it was called in the end in 2015, that is, inside or outside with the same relational forces, etc. And then, which of course would say, listen, if you want an economy or society like this, yes, it might be a disaster to live, but if you want something different, which in the long, run is much better for the subaltern classes and the real productive forces of this country, then yes, you should try exit. Now, in this sense, popular sovereignty and reclaiming popular sovereignty in the great case would not simply be about international relations. Now, of course, as I think people said enough of that, popular sovereignty is by itself a very contradictory a contradiction in terms, such as that the very notion of sovereignty and the people are also are not necessarily commensurate. But it's also, but it's interesting how he brought forward that, that other crucial concept, which is on the basis of the very conception of democratic but also revolutionary political practice of modernity, the will of the people. If we're trying to rethink the will of the people, I would suggest the way in the Marxist tradition, Antonio Gramsci offered a rethinking of the notion, linking it, his conception of hegemony, the modern prince, and the historical law. For Gramsci, one of the stakes of modern politics and the crucial aspect of the formation of what he calls the modern prince is, and I quote, the formation of a national popular collective will. Here, the will of the people is not simply a momentary political passion, it's not simply the expression of a common will in the moment of revolutionary upsurge. It is a social and political process, it is a political project, it is the outcome of a molecular process of hegemony. It requires the function of hegemonic apparatus, it requires the forms of subaltern self-organization, and it requires the emergence of the modern priest, the political organization of front. That could be the terrain of the encounter of the different subaltern movements, experiences, and sensitivities, and the laboratory of new and critical forms of mass political intellectuality. So, in this sense, reclaiming popular sovereignty is also a process of creating a people. When I refer to creating a people, I'm referring to a complex process of not just articulating a social alliance, but what we might call, again, with Gramsci in terms of potential historical bloc. That is, the historical dynamic of a different form of hegemony in the sense not only of a broad alliance of the subaltern classes, but also of a transitional program that would offer an alternative non-capitalist narrative, and also the political forms of an expansive participatory democracy well beyond contemporary parliamentarism. Now, but why to create a people? Because there is this tension inside the very notion of the people as it has been arrived to us. In one hand, it is the identification of people with the nation. This is something that is part of our political history, trajectory, and tradition, which we also understand that it might have had the emancipatory aspect of national liberation. It also had the aspect of legitimization of bourgeois hegemony, of, or can even fuel nationalism, racism, or offering legitimation for colonialism. And on the other hand, you have, especially in the moments of the grand and big social and political revolutions of modernity, the emergence of the people as exactly this kind of democratic, emancipatory dynamic. And you can see it from Spinoza's references to potential multitudinous as the defining force of the modern state, from to the very notion of constitutive power, or to the acceptance of popular will, or to the 20th century conceptualization of social revolution as popular revolt. You can see this aspect. So there is a tension here, and it's something that we should try and work upon. So I think that the only way to deal with this tension is exactly to work towards a redefinition of the people based not upon common origin, ethnicity, or history, but upon the contemporary condition of subalternity in the context of contemporary capitalist accumulation, which in a certain way has also expanded the linkages between subalternity and subjection to capitalist exploitation in both direct and indirect ways. So it requires moving the notion of the people towards common condition present, a struggle, and it's also a scissoring, a dividing conception of the people, because it includes an oppositional approach to the enemies of the people, even if many of them are nominally members of the nation. So this is a post-national and decolonial conception of the people, a politically performative conception the people, or as Gramsci would have said, the people nation, popolo nazione. Of course, and it's interesting that I have a good quote from Deleuze, it's a disagreement we have with Peter regarding Deleuze and its relevant to politics, but I find an interesting quote. It says, "It's not the myth of a past people, but the storytelling of a people to come. The speech act must create itself as a foreign language in a dominant language, precisely in order to express an impossibility of living under domination." I like this quote exactly, this image of the people to come instead of the nation that was. Because I think it is here that we can find the potential collective will of all those that live at a specific geographical space, serve the same condition and the same desire for a better life, and want to struggle together against all those that exploit and oppress them. And this is, of course, this is not easy. It requires overcoming barriers that are real and differences that are real. It requires lots of storytelling and lots of acceptance of other histories, other traditions, other stories, other traumas. It requires facing the trauma of racism or colonialism and trying to overcome it. It requires accepting that some people will still require their own right to their own identity or their own history instead of simply being integrated in a new common identity. But I think it is the only way to go forward. I think that it also, the way to go forward this also depends upon what is the actual condition of the national popular element. I use this phrase in the Gramsci sense of the term. In its country-specific history, I think that, for example, in a country like Greece, with a history, a real history of struggles, and of course not many negative aspects of race, but still, the history of the national popular element in Greece would be more open to such a new conception of the people to come, which also means that things like we must see things that we do in a non-instrumental way. For example, solidarity with migrants and refugees is not just solidarity, not just helping someone else. It's exactly the attempt to create this kind of linkages that will help the emergence of these people to come. But I would like to say 2 points. One, I think that there's been a lot of talk about the people as a discursive element, as a signifying process, as a discursive construction. I still insist that we can find the right base, although I believe that in the end it is politically performative, it is also based upon a conception of class analysis. I believe that we can still, I think Poulanger's referred to the people as a strategic concept referring to the possibility of a social alliance between working class, second bourgeois segments, other popular forces. So this is one point to make. Yes, and well, of course, it's obvious that I push the notion of the popular will and popular sovereignty beyond its association with the actual existing, let's say, bourgeois capitalist source of information, because I believe that the only way really to see the emergence of a potential of the people, of the will of the people, is only if you think it as the democratic moment in communism as a material difference.
Okay, thank you very much, Peter and Panagiotis, and also for these philosophers sticking to the time. So I'm sure you have lots of questions and comments to each other, but I would like to open the floor for questions, and then maybe if you have any disagreeing comments as well. So, are there any questions?
I'd like to thank you both. I basically agree with much of what you both said, but that brings me into an awkward position. Because it seems to me that if we start, let's say, from Panagiotis' argument, we can slowly start deconstructing some of the things that Peter was saying. And if we start from Peter's starting point, we can end up deconstructing some of the things that Panagiotis brought. For example, the Greek referendum was, perhaps, I don't agree with that, an expression of popular will.
I agree.
Yeah. So, but why not? I mean, what are really the differences? I mean, from a certain point of view, I would say that, for example, the willing to prepare the question that was posed made the British referendum more genuine. And the other way around, if, for example, the Brits are entitled to a second referendum, that should apply even more to the ideas, because the question posed in the referendum concerned the acceptance or not of the particular package, but not concerned members of the European Union or the Eurozone. So, presumably, after the term of referendum, we should have a second referendum saying, okay, this didn't work out, the European Union is not accepting that, would you like to leave or not? And there, we would end up, I think, in a position in which we would have to really encounter the hegemony of a crypto-colonial logic in the Greek case, which would probably not allow the situation to end up in a vote in favor of getting out of the European Union or the Eurozone. And that would be, I think, the real problem to think about. And that would be a failure not only of Syria, but all the people that were involved in this whole situation.
Yeah. Well, but just because I think this is where the ambiguity of the notion of national emancipation or national self-determination means something very different for a colonized country or formerly colonized country or a colonial country, a colonizing country. So national self-determination in Britain is not a progressive position, in my view, because of its, precisely because of that history. The idea is that I would talk a little bit about Brexit, and I would just talk a bit about Greece, and then we wouldn't try to talk too much about the other one. But I agree very much, not only now, but with your analysis at the time. The ambiguity of it is that what was the further dimension? You said that people were prepared to leave the European Union, but that is exactly the issue.
How as if they were ready to accept it as a possible outcome, and they said that they would.
Maybe not. But then that is the question, and that is what something like a real movement for popular self-determination would have absolutely embraced that decision and debate it, discuss it, so I would very much agree with all that. If I could just take a second, because the thing that I find that the line of, because I agree with very much with what you say. My question, and I come back to you, and it's a question, so I'm curious what other people think about this, is what is the relation between people and class? So in your talk, you said in the end, people based on class analysis, you refer to the primacy of the condition of subalternity, or the experience based on exploitation, and that the idea then is that in some sense, the experience of exploitation or domination is primary, and from that you can build people to come, right? But I think that's the problem, or that's the question, because already in Marx, arguably, the point of departure is a concept of people, generic people. The proletariat in the early formulations is just the form for humanity as such that has been lost under conditions of capitalist alienation. Right? So we could argue that the concept of proletariat begins with the concept of humanity, generic species being. That is your point of departure, and then you refine a class analysis from the primacy of people, in fact, even of humanity. But you can also make a case that said that as Marx goes down that road, it is the what becomes primary determinant is class. So that the figure of the people becomes in many ways, as you say, just a figure of bourgeois legitimation, and it has played that role often, you know, in Italy, in many, many places, it's not even worth listing. But then you left an ambiguity in late Marx, in Kautsky, in Lenin, even still in Gramsci, and I share your enthusiasm for Gramsci, of so what is it that is primary? And you have to, I think, ask the question, which would be the Rousseau-Jacobin question, well, what is it that makes a certain group of people more politically progressive or reliable, more invested in justice, more invested in what in their terms the common good. And you can ask them, why should we assume that the workers are invested in that? And the classical answer is because they fight exploitation, because they fight injustice and oppression. But you can perfectly see, and therefore they are the most interested in resolute action against capital, unlike the peasantry of the petty bourgeoisie, which vacillates, right? Which is politically has a kind of wavering psychology. The proletariat is clear, they're resolute, they're determined. But I think in Marx, through Lenin, what you see is the conflation of two things, a political psychology of resolute commitment to the good, if you like, to justice, and a historical narrative of the logic of the way capital develops, which will inevitably force the proletariat into a position of ultimate conflict and lead to their likely triumph. And it's that second part that I think has become very hard to defend. The problem in Britain, for example, is that the experience of exploitation is not a unifying experience. It's a divided one, and you see it all the time. Likewise in the United States, this is maybe an important difference. If you've grown up in somewhere like the United States or Canada, like I did, the experience of exploitation is the experience of division. You see it all the time. Groups played off against each other, working classes divided around ethnic and national and racist lines and so on, and many other lines too, and that is the primary experience. To build against that, you need something more than class analysis. That is where I think we both agree that you have to build something. The process that the Jacobins would call broadly political education, the building of the common interest, is something that I think has to be built, and you do it not simply on the basis of the experience of exploitation, but that can be manipulated very easily, in fact, to divide them.
Oh, I totally agree with that, and I agree that there is a tension in Marx, which was never resolved, between the working class, the proletariat, and the masses. I refer to a good article by Vladimir on that, translated in Greek, not translated, or not easy to find in any other language, which basically
emphasizing the emancipatory aspect, which you cannot find in traditional, if it's hijacked by nationalist or right-wing populist forces.
Yep.
This is basically the challenge. And well, in the end, yes, it is a question of hegemony. It's a question of crafting a common political project, which also includes Gramsci, would have called it a moral and educational reform. That is,
it's a very technical term.
Yeah, which is interesting. He uses this term, whereas in some French writings of the same, of some passages, he uses the term cultural revolution in the sense of the early Soviet Union use of the term, which basically is the same thing. So in this sense, I agree. And the question is, and the lessons to be learned is exactly that you have to work at, although time can be compressed, you have to try to work at both temporality. Both the temporality of the moment and the temporality of the convergence of such a moment, and perhaps the weakness in the Greek case, I would say, that which might limit, might define the distance between preparedness and readiness, was not only on the top side. That's why I never referred to treason or things like that in my presentation. I'm very clear on that. It was also on the part of the government forces. Because there was anger, there was, let's say that the moral and intellectual reform had started in a shockwave kind of approach after the cathartic moment of the 2010 imposition of the memoranda, but it had not been consolidated into a different hegemony, which would have meant that even if you had, let's say, I would say in quotation marks, treason at the top, you would have someone taking over coming from the part of the popular forces. So I'm not, so yes, the question of forming, the question is again, how do you work towards the creation of the people and the creation of the leader of the world of the people?
Yeah. More questions?
Could I just say that regarding the world of people in England, people seem to forget it's a very small majority that voted for Brexit. It's something like 1,200,000.
Yes.
And us, I voted to remain, and we seem to be the forgotten part of the population who want to stay in Europe.
Yes.
As for immigration, I think the statistics were for 2015-16. Far more coming in from outside the EU to Britain. If we wanted to stop immigration, it was far more easier to stop people at the borders coming in from outside the EU, obviously, than stopping the immigration coming in from within the EU.
Right. Which tells you that it wasn't about that primarily, because the British employers and the British state has been going around the world taking well-qualified, well-paid people, nurses and so on, from all over the world, right?
Yes, I mean, we rely on an awful lot of EU immigration to keep our country running, as regards picking fruit in the summer, so many industries, the entertainment, hospitality industry, 75% apparently rely on EU immigration to keep it ticking over. If you go to any coffee shop in England, I can't speak for the whole of the country, but you hardly hear an English voice serving you. They're all from Eastern Europe, maybe, or other parts of Europe, but we don't seem to get people in, the young indigenous British, if I may call you that, who want to work in that kind of positions where people from the EU will come and work. I mean, just those two very basic reasons, I think it's a bad idea that we're leaving.
Well, the one thing that's constant, whether you're in the EU or not, because it happens in North America too, is the racial division of labor that we inherited from colonialism and much else. So if you work in a university, you can pretty much tell what people do by the color of their skin, whether they teach or, you know, clean the office. And is that being generalized across the board? So the question is, in a country like Britain, what would enable something like a real solidarity across groups, across occupations, and so on. Something like the kind of class solidarity, something based on the common experience of what it is to be exploited. And that, I think, was a pivotal question in the Brexit debate. But I can't see how leaving the EU helps, you know, makes the conditions for building that solidarity better or more encouraging. I mean, on the contrary, what it did then in the debate, and I think immediately after, in a sense, is build up the case for chauvinism and a sense of a kind of retreating back of British, you know, British jobs for British workers, or Britain for the British, like, you know, really, pretty much. A very unpromising basis, let's say, for building something like international solidarity.
Yes. May I ask the two gentlemen this very simple question? Don't you think that the Brexit, or whatever exit, automatically leads to nationalism, and nationalism leads to conservatism?
Leads to what?
To conservatism.
Conservatism, yeah.
That's a big question, but I think that you have nationalism, you must have a certain, and you have this kind of exit to being leading to conservatism, nationalism. It depends upon the social forces that we can elicit. And I think that it's impossible for forces, all the progressive democratic, emancipatory, whatever, to take the initiative in this sense, project this kind of conversion. I also think that in countries like Greece, I'm not saying about Greece, Britain is different, it is only, let's say, in classical terms, class analysis in the interest of the supporting classes to choose perhaps their own exit. You don't have, you have a very impressive alignment of the dominant social forces, be it in industry or finance, with the European project. So I'm not sure that you would get that kind of conservatism. It's interesting. It's interesting that, because nationalism in Greece has a very particular tradition, we have a very strong tradition of right-wing nationalism coming from the divisions of the civil war, etc. And it's interesting that the Greek far right, in its many varieties, was never really Eurosceptic. It has been only in a very opportunistic electoral way, which is also an interesting difference from other countries. Other countries have real Eurosceptic right-wing forces. So I think that the only way to combat this is exactly by the way you will wage the debate and the way you will set the terms of the debate and whoever is taking the initiative in opening up this debate. I would say, for example, in a country like France, what was the French example? Shows that when progressive forces leave this question to the right wing, then it is dominated by the right wing. Mm-hmm. You have a country that has been, it has a very deeply rooted, and mainly to a large extent expressing working class sentiments and popular class sentiments against further integration. France was divided in the 1922 referendum on the entrance to the Maastricht Treaty. It was the country that said no to the European Constitution. So, and if you see the social statistics, it was always mainly more to the subaltern. Yet, in the political spectrum, the larger force that talks about some form of Euroscepticism, I would call it personally, and if that's not real Euroscepticism, is Front National, which in my opinion is a systemic party. It's not an anti-systemic party, and you can see also.
I think that's again a different discussion.
Yeah, but I'm just saying.
Okay. Yeah.
I'm just saying that. But so if you leave the political space, yes. The problem is, are you going to leave this the political question to the such?
They voted. They made a decision. The government said, yes, we will go with this decision. This is something that hasn't happened in the rest of Europe for some time. It's interesting. I'm not trying to counter your argument. I understand your points about the terms of the debate, but it's interesting, and this shows the extent of the erosion of democracy in the rest of the European Union, that the contrast was very, very obvious. When popular opinion in many parts of the Europe was, okay, they have a referendum, then they're going to sort of do something and not go forward with it. You would hear people saying that.
But
they didn't debate that anymore. And then seeing that it went forward.
Well, we'll see, by the
way. I'm also have a question about the referendum. No, let's go.
So you have to, just to comment, I'll answer your question in a second, but on that, you have to ask, so why does the Tory party want to push through this referendum, in other words, on the vote, even though it's bad for much of the business community, which is to say their core support, and arguably, you know, many people say very self-destructive, in just very economic terms, for the prevailing classes. And I'm afraid the only answer that seems to make sense for me is not because they really revere popular sovereignty and would love, they could organize a referendum on any topic they like, and you know, it's the last thing that they want to do. They're jealous about their parliamentary sovereignty, don't forget, which itself is just a sham for the logic of the realm. You know, it's really the opposite of the people as the masses. Why do they want to do it? Because there is a big part of British capital and British business that wants to tear up all the rules, and then sees this as a big opportunity to get rid of those, as you say, those residual social benefits that in Britain are, the EU still stands as a more progressive force than the Thatcherite, you know, status quo. And that, as they said, we would happily have no deal at all. In other words, turn Britain into a low-cost offshore economy where basically people work for low wages and where you have a rentier economy. And they're quite open about it. They don't even pretend. One of the amazing things, a big difference between Thatcher and this, is that Thatcher had a promise, whether or not it was true. She said, if you do these things, if you break the power of the unions, if you free up markets, if you privatize the railways, etc., you will have better things. Basically, you will get rich. That was the thing, right? Society doesn't exist, it's all, unions are bad, but you, and she was talking to a lot of working class people, you will own your council flat, your children will own your your railway will run better, your shares will go up in value, and a lot of working class people did get richer. So she could say, that's how they sold this whole package, right? Is that we'll break up a lot of nice social things, but you will get richer. And enough people bought that to get her re-elected and to get basically shaped the last 30 years. So the neoliberal package was sold and bought by a large number of people, not a majority, maybe, but a large number, enough to win elections. But this, the Brexit, is not being sold at all. It's like that. No one is saying, you will be better off, your children will go to university but you didn't, you will benefit. There's no one saying that at all. They're just saying, it's this or we are all destroyed and doomed. This is the best way to fight in the world of global cutthroat competition. This, to lower our wages, to get rid of corporation tax, is the only way to fight in this cutthroat world. And that's the message they're trying to sell. And it's a measure of how desperate and afraid a lot of people are that they buy it. But that's not a good way to sell a message. That will not hold. Anyway, so I think it's a much weaker, Thatcher was ideologically a much stronger proposition for the British, ruling class than this is. And so I actually think that it won't, I think they will buckle, in fact, at a certain point, and they will try to fudge it, and because it's ultimately not enough business wants to tear up all the rules. And to answer your question, I think I'm, it's a very interesting question, but there is an alternative. There's a kind of patriotic internationalist alternative to that, that, say, Lenin in particular defended, but many of the Bolsheviks defended the right to secede, the right to national self-determination, that they saw as consistent with building international solidarity. And they went, I think, undertook quite concrete steps to do that and to pose the question of colonial independence and so on in ways that were really very groundbreaking and very progressive. For all the limits, the project later. You see it again in, say, the Cuban Revolution, and the sense of winning a kind of patriotic national self-determination that could then be the inspiration. inspiration for something more like a regional project and ultimately a tricontinental project. And I think there's still something patriotic self-determination as a means to something bigger that is not necessarily conservative, and that at least for
example,
I would call it patriotism, and it can easily fold into nationalism, but it doesn't necessarily have to, and it doesn't necessarily need to become a conservative. Or in the case of, you know, I grew up in Quebec, and in Quebec there were repeated referenda, and then the movement for national, you know, national souveraineté nationale, which is always the expression, was a progressive movement in the late 60s, early 70s, through to maybe the early 80s. And then the people who fought and struggled for national independence for Quebec were people who also supported the anti-colonial struggles, who supported the Vietnamese against imperialism and so on. It was the same, they saw it as the same project. But then, so the same argument in favor of national sovereignty in Quebec now is essentially a neoliberal argument, or very often, the party that supports it now is a broadly an austerity party, the Parti Québécois. But there are still people who would support a different independence. So it's not the question of secession or leaving or becoming independent that makes it one way or the other. I think it's what people want. In other words, the more fundamental notion is this idea of something like the will of the people, or what people really want, and then what they're prepared to do. And there, I think, even in the case of Britain, the movement for Scottish independence, which I imagine got some coverage here, that referendum was a much more interesting political process because it really did build. It was more likely for people, perhaps. It did bring people together. It was, you know, rooted in grassroots debate and deliberation in a much more important way. I think that Scotland is a much more progressive place than England on balance. I mean, it's hard to generalize, but there's a legacy of social justice and solidarity and so on, but it's stronger in Scotland, I think, for historical reasons. So would Scottish independence lead, you know, necessarily to nationalism and conservatism? I mean, it might. There's also a rather ugly nationalist side in Scotland, and as there is, by the way, in Quebec, because in Quebec, you know, and certainly there is in England, you know, an English side. And so I think Brexit, as it will play out, as it did play out in the campaign, will whip up a certain nationalism, a national chauvinism, and that is quite conservative, yes. And so I worry about it. And I think that's why Brexit and Brexit are very, quite different things.
Okay, so we're running out of time. I think we have time for just one question, and then you can answer briefly.
I would like to ask Peter about the relations between the Brexit vote and the results in the elections. I mean, that there was a fear that after Brexit, the British society would turn conservative and nationalist. But 1 year later, the Tories lost a lot of their power, and an agenda that was anti-racist and anti-austerity is now rising. What is really happening? Because I think that Brexit might be very concrete in getting out of the European Union, but at the same time, works like an empty ceasefire. I mean that what Brexit really is, what happened is that it accelerated the polarization, and there are certain parts of the subaltern classes that have voted for Brexit and 1 year later for Labour. And I think that this is a very interesting part that has been lost in the way that you handled, you described the situation. To finish with the last phrase, because my position is, which is very near to Panagiotis, is that for the British left, the real internationalist position right now is to prove that there could be a left Brexit. If a left Brexit was very weak in its campaign during the referendum, now it's a real challenge ahead.
Yes. Well, that is the current. You know, that is what people have to do. That's what Corbyn and McDonald are trying to do. It's true. But my view is that people who voted, you could go back one step. So the people who voted for Brexit 10 years, 20 years before that voted Labour. And they voted Labour for broadly, you know, social democratic reasons. And before that they might have supported a genuinely progressive Labour Party. But by the time they, you know, the year or two before Brexit, they might have voted UKIP, or they might have voted, you know, a Conservative Party. At the time of the established opinion. So it said that the range of political possibilities is bigger than had been acknowledged, because on balance most people did not expect this result. And so the opinion makers, so-called, did not expect it to happen. Cameron himself certainly did not expect it to happen. So in that sense it was a surprise, and any kind of surprise expands the sphere of the possible. But one of the things that's consistent, I think, is that many of the people who support Corbyn now, and I'm one of them, and I think it is a hopeful thing, regret that he didn't take a stronger line on Brexit. So you hear it over and over, we like Corbyn, but we wish he had been stronger about making a progressive case for Remain. In other words, a left Remain. And that felt like a missed opportunity, and part of the reason why a lot of people didn't come out to vote, a lot of young people did not vote, overwhelmingly young people wanted to stay in, but they didn't vote, in part because they thought, well, it's pointless and we don't need to, but also because Corbyn didn't make a very strong case. Labour was not a very strong presence. But I think it is extremely hopeful that now that there is a kind of remobilising people around Corbyn, and I hope also, by the way, that what that will do, in fact, is lead to something like a left Brexit that ultimately will mean something more like a left re-engagement with Europe, a left renewal of Europe. Whether that, how much of the existing architecture that Panagiotis described, I agree very much with its purpose, its class bias, its fundamental logic. So all that has to be disassembled. But how do you disassemble it? Do you disassemble it from the inside or from the outside? I mean, it's the same kind of question you would have had before any radical political change. How do you reform the ancien regime in France? How do you reform the British state before World War I? How do you reform the Russian Empire before World War I? And each time it would have seemed an impossibly daunting task, very difficult. How do you, the British state before World War I was a closed aristocratic clique. The idea that you could turn that into something in 3 decades that would become a fairly progressive body would have seemed very difficult. So it seems to me that we're comparing the difficulties of very daunting projects, and that it still strikes me as more difficult to imagine a progressive Britain outside Europe than inside. But I very much hope that you're right, that actually that's what will happen, and that will be part of a renewal of Europe, and perhaps with other places on it, what will then be an expansion periphery of Europe. Parts of Northern Europe that might include Greece, that might include Spain and Portugal and so on. But we'll see.
Do you have one final point, Mark?
Well, just like to make points. One is that question, of course, Peter knows we are in Britain much more. But, I mean, this coincidence between the Brexit vote and a certain liberating effect in British society and politics, they might be two different dynamics, but the coincidence in time seems interesting to me, because it's not just the latest election. You've seen interesting things, really interesting. The reaction to the Manchester attacks, the reaction to the Grenfell Towers tragedy. There's a difference, really, in contrast to other societies. British society, which was in a certain way apex of neoliberal alienation, we might say. Now it's becoming more interesting and more humane in its collective practices. So what I would like to suggest, but with a very, very big question mark, is that perhaps this is like an unwanted effect of Brexit as a democratic process. I understand, even if we agree that it was not a full expression of democratic, a real democratic expression of the will of the people, was a moment closer to democracy than if it had not happened. And this can have a liberating effect, in my opinion, by itself. It shows that things can be done, and this can also point to a different direction. And I mean, that's my point. I mean, in this sense, I think that that's why I still think that the question of progressive Brexit still is the agenda for progressive forces. I don't think that it's so easy to have this kind of
change at the European level, because you don't, it's, the question is if you can have some sort of a, you know, a will of the people at the European level. In Britain, all the examples you used, one way or the other, it became possible, whether it was the Danzig regime, or whether it was the British Empire, or whether it was the Russian Empire, you had a way to express a will of the people, and in a very radical and at least in France, the Russian revolutionary. I'm not sure if it can be invented.
But hang on, just on that point, because that's important. If you think about France or Russia before the revolutions, I mean, think of what they were like geographically, culturally, linguistically. They were divided imperial units. There was no France to speak of before the French Revolution. The revolution made it into a place, and it made it into a place that wasn't French. They didn't emphasize the Frenchness of it. It was the place of universal natural right. It was the place of, you know, unequivocal principle. So likewise, the Russian Revolution, for the revolutionaries, was a site in the world revolution, a certain European revolution. And they built this thing that overcame, you know, borders, that accommodated a degree of national self-determination all over the place and all the different separate states that become the Soviet republics. And they built it, and it was to be part of it. The Haitian Revolution, by the way, is exactly the same, maybe the most interesting case, because that there was no nation, and there was no common underlying space. They invented it, and it could have got bigger. I mean, arguably, you know, it does spread into Latin America.
Well, even if the scale of Greek society, in creating a collective subject that would take a country in a very different developmental, political, social, cultural road, it requires the same process. But even if I accept this point, I would still subscribe more to the logic of the Russian revolution as part of the world revolution. In this sense, you need to start from the weakest link in order to see change at the world level.
But that's not the Britain road. Maybe
no, I'm not saying the Britain road.
We're having this conversation already. I know we need to finish, but in a way that you couldn't have had easily 30 or 40 years ago. People know, there's a, you know, France did turn itself into a political community of a kind. Same with the Soviet Union of a kind. Same with Haiti, same with other examples we can give. And Europe has done some of that. I mean, Europe's, you know, the point's always made, but Europe's history is not exactly inspiring.
You had, that's interesting, you had sovereign